Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Girl in the Leaves by Robert Scott, with Sarah Maynard and Larry Maynard. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. 1. He's a Real Weirdo. Mount Vernon, Ohio, November 2010. Relations between Donna Davis, whose name would often be spelled as Donna in future accounts and articles, and her next-door neighbor on Columbus Road in Mount Vernon, Ohio, had not always been strained. Donna, the mother of three children, initially liked the young man, 30-year-old Matthew Hoffman, who resided next door in a two-story house with his girlfriend and her 8-year-old son. In fact, Donna's eldest son often went over to Hoffman's house to play with the girlfriend's son. The two boys would toss a football around, watch TV, and just generally hang out together after school. Donna's friend Leanda Klein agreed that Hoffman was friendly in the beginning and referred to him as a nice guy. Leanda's son, who would also play over at Hoffman's house, told her that Hoffman let the boys jump around on a trampoline and made popcorn for them, too. They would often sit in front of the TV watching a DVD and eat popcorn. Donna and Leanda's sons also had sleepovers at Hoffman's house, and on occasion, Hoffman would give Donna's 14-year-old daughter rides home from the movie theater in Mount Vernon. All in all, he seemed just as Leanda had indicated, a nice guy. But near the end of summer 2010, Matt Hoffman began to change. He became more irritable and moody. One day, his dogs suddenly disappeared. Donna later said, "I believe in my heart that he killed those dogs. He started pulling back and acting strange. I don't know what set him off. He was just getting more and more weird." Around the same time, Hoffman began setting squirrel traps around his yard. Donna learned from his girlfriend that Hoffman was catching the squirrels, taking them into his house, butchering them, and eating them. On occasion, the girlfriend said, he would even barbecue the squirrels. It freaked Donna out. She said later, "We liked those squirrels and used to feed them. And then he killed them." Donna quit letting her daughter ride home from the movie theater with Hoffman when she learned he was taking the girl on indirect routes home. These roads ran through sparsely populated areas of woods away from the main logical route back to Columbus Road. Donna's daughter told her, "We didn't take the main roads back home. We took back roads. It made me uncomfortable." Donna also quit letting her son play next door. Hoffman was just becoming too weird in her estimation. Hoffman's girlfriend was changing as well. She had initially been talkative and outgoing. But as autumn came along in 2010, she became more reserved and quiet. In fact, by that point, whenever she came over to see Donna, it was almost as if she had to sneak out of Hoffman's house so that he wouldn't know that she was there. It got so bad that Donna and Leanda later said they began to fear for her safety. "We knew something was wrong." It was more than just a gut feeling on their part. In mid-October, an incident brought to light just how much Matt Hoffman had changed from the nice guy next door neighbor into something else. Hoffman's girlfriend had finally had enough of his increasingly bizarre behavior, and she and her son moved out of his house. She came back one day to pick up some items that she'd left behind, and almost immediately she and Hoffman got into an argument. As it became more heated, she started to leave, but he pushed her over a chair and knocked her to the floor. Then he began choking her. She later related in a police report, "We were in his living room, talking, and he got upset and pushed me against a wall. He had his forearm up against my neck and was choking me. I got loose, but he grabbed me again, and we tumbled over a chair to the floor. I was fighting to try and get him off me, but he choked me on the ground." She estimated that they struggled for 2 minutes, with him choking her on and off as they rolled around on the floor. Finally, he let her up, and they spoke briefly before she left his house. She reported the incident to the police, but then, for whatever reasons, decided not to press charges. After Hoffman's girlfriend and son moved out, Donna no longer let her children go anywhere near Hoffman. In fact, she wouldn't even let them play in their own yard if Hoffman was outside. He was too erratic, in her estimation, to be anywhere around her children. And his habits were becoming more and more strange. On occasion, he would climb up into the branches of a large tree on his property and perch up there for hours. Just what or who he was looking for, Donna didn't know. He would also spend great amounts of time in a hammock in a tree. He seemed to be obsessed with trees. By now, Hoffman gave Donna the creeps. As if that wasn't enough, Hoffman, who had always been addicted to computers, had his electricity turned off. Suddenly, even that outlet for him was gone. With winter coming on, it seemed crazy to be without such power, but crazy is exactly the word Donna now used to describe Hoffman. She soon started letting everyone know, he's a real weirdo. Matt Hoffman didn't care what Donna Davis or anyone else thought of him. He had always marched to a beat of a different drum. For example, more than 10 years earlier, when he was 19 years old, he had left Ohio and moved to Colorado, where he had gotten himself into a great deal of trouble. Though he rationalized to himself that he had mainly been the victim of bad luck, that bad luck had cost him prison time and made him a very angry young man. After his prison stint, Hoffman had moved back to Ohio, where his mother lived, as a condition of his parole. He got a job as a tree trimmer, which suited him. He had always liked being in and around trees. Like his neighbors, his employer at Fast Eddie's, a grounds maintenance and tree trimming service in Mount Vernon, at first thought Hoffman was a nice guy. Office manager Sandy Bird later said, "There was nothing strange about him in the beginning. He just blended in. But as time went on, he struck me as really strange. He would just stare off into space." Not only that, but Bird learned that Hoffman had oversold his tree trimming experience and had not disclosed that he had been in prison. Hoffman's actions became so troubling that at the end of October 2010, he was let go from his job. Hoffman was bitter as October turned to November 2010. Now, as Hoffman sat in his house, with no job, no electricity, no gas, and no girlfriend, he became more and more angry. He was worked up and agitated, and when he was in such a state, he had to blow off steam. That's when his urges were at their strongest. And the urge right now was as it had been back in Colorado. He liked breaking into people's homes, people who led normal lives. He didn't consider himself to be normal. He thought of himself as extraordinary. The rules that pertained to others didn't pertain to him. When he felt these urges, he was a man of action, and he acted upon them come hell or high water. He knew about a place in the town of Howard named Apple Valley. It was a house that sat alone on a street across from some woods. Best of all, its garage door would not close all the way, giving easy access into the interior of the house. He'd wait until all the people in the house had left for the day, and then he'd sneak inside and take whatever he wanted. Hoffman got a charge out of those kinds of things and was no stranger to breaking and entering. 2. Larry and Tina, 1993, Central Ohio. 15-year-old Larry Maynard was riding his bike down the street in his neighborhood of Reynoldsburg, Ohio, when he spotted one of the cutest girls he'd ever seen. She was blonde, petite, and athletic-looking. Wanting to know more about her, Larry kept pedaling his bike past her block, hoping each time to get another glimpse of her. Before long, he learned that she was the same age he was, and her name was Tina Herman. Larry already knew Tina's elder brother, and discovered that she was staying the summer with him, though she usually lived in the small town of Pataskala, which was much more of a farming community about 10 miles farther east. When school resumed in the fall, Larry and Tina started hanging out together every chance they got, despite the distance between their homes. Along with being cute, Tina was outgoing and popular. She had an infectious laugh and upbeat personality. Lots of teenagers, Larry included, liked being in Tina's orbit. Larry recalled, "There was just something about her that made you like her. Not just me, but lots of kids at school. You hear about someone lighting up a room? Tina was one of those people." After a few months, Larry and Tina began officially dating. They did the usual teenage things, going to movies, sitting down to burgers and fries, cruising around with friends. Though they didn't go to the same high school, Larry and Tina were a couple. She liked watching him play on the football and basketball teams. Both took school seriously, and Larry and Tina adopted a work ethic early on in life. Neither came from wealthy families, and they realized that no one was going to just hand them money as they grew older. Larry began doing jobs with his grandfather, a professional painter of houses and businesses, and Tina started working at a Kmart store. Soon after graduating high school, they got an apartment together on the outskirts of Columbus. In April 1997, when Larry and Tina were both 19, Tina was rushed to the hospital and gave birth to a baby girl 6 weeks premature. Larry was stunned when he heard the news at work. He had not expected the baby to be born so premature. Larry made a beeline to the hospital, where he was presented with his baby daughter, only 4 pounds, 9 ounces, whom he and Tina named Sarah. Larry recalled, "She was so tiny. It seemed incredible that she was alive. She looked so fragile." Sarah changed our world. It was as if our responsibilities had just doubled. I was determined to give Sarah the best life possible. Larry's mother, Esther Maynard, recalled, "When my son called to tell me I was a grandma, I thought he was joking since it was April Fool's Day." She was surprised as well that the baby was so premature. Esther continued, "It was true, however, and my daughter and I hurried to the hospital to see her. Sarah was premature, with lots of wires attached to her. Sarah was a fighter, though, and became strong very quickly and continued to show strength every day. Despite Sarah's small size, she began to flourish more every day. In some ways, she seemed to adopt Tina's vibrant vitality early on. Friends and family oohed and awed over her, and she developed a happy quality that became the hallmark of her young life. Sarah gained more and more weight as each month progressed, and slowly but surely, the underweight baby turned into a healthy, athletic girl, as her mother had been. Running around the house, getting into mischief, but basically a good, happy child. Sarah was a bundle of energy. 2 years later, Sarah was presented with a baby brother, whom Larry and Tina named Kody. And just like his sister, Kody was also born tiny and premature. But once again, just like Sarah, Kody soon developed into a happy, healthy baby. In no time, he too was a burst of energy, crawling all over the house like a little dynamo. Larry said, "He turned into a real live wire, just like his sister." Sarah doted on her baby brother. There was a real bond between those two. I was real proud of both my kids. They were also very kind, and they always shared with others. I don't even know how much of that was learned. It was just who they were. Larry's mother, Esther, recalled that Sarah and Kody both loved bicycles. "We started out with little ones and worked our way up to big kids' bikes. I would watch them ride their bikes up and down the sidewalk until they got tired. They were so happy. I always tried to make sure they knew how much I loved them." Now, with a growing family, there was even more pressure on Larry and Tina to provide a good life for them. Because neither Larry or Tina had college education, the prospect of good-paying jobs was limited. Larry looked around and discovered that one of the best-paying jobs within his grasp was becoming a long-haul truck driver. The work suited him. He wanted to drive a large truck since he was 5 years old, when he'd sat in the cab of a relative's truck and imagined how it would be to be behind the wheel of such a large vehicle. Larry knew that he could make a good long-haul truck driver, but he also knew the job would be a double-edged sword. Even though the money was good, it would take him away from Tina and the kids for extended periods of time. At the kids' young age, they would be changing all the time, and Larry wouldn't be able to see those changes for weeks at a time. Larry recalled, "I began trucking all over America, mainly because I wanted Sarah and Kody to have a nice home. The company was based in Florida, and I would haul roses and other plants to mom-and-pop florist shops all over the eastern states. I'd also drive out to California and other western states. There were times I wouldn't be home for 6 to 8 weeks because I'd be driving a load to someplace and then picking up another load there. That way, I wouldn't be driving empty trailers on a return trip." All of this put a lot of stress on me and Tina. She was working, too, at a Myers grocery store by that time and also having to raise the kids a lot on her own. It got to be like Tina and I were passing by each other right in our own home. I'd be there for just a little while and then back on the road again. Even when I was home, I was pretty tired. It was like Tina and I were becoming strangers to each other. Tina and the kids lived with Larry's grandmother in a nice house in the township of Hamilton, south of Columbus. It was a pretty suburban area, surrounded by fields and orchards. The locale had a small-town feel to it, much as Reynoldsburg had. From Ohio to New York to Florida, from Ohio to California and Washington State, Larry's trucking took him on multi-week runs. He began to know the inside of his truck cab better than he did his own home. There were still good times with the family, trips to the Columbus Zoo, rides for the kids at amusement parks and barbecues, but these times were like islands in an ocean. Cracks started developing in the relationship between Larry and Tina, and as time went on, they became wider and wider. Tina wanted a man who was there to help her raise Sarah and Kody. She felt frustrated and lonely. For his part, Larry wanted to provide for Tina and their two kids, but had to be on the road in order to do so. The arguments between Larry and Tina became cyclical and seemed unsolvable, and they were inexorably drifting apart. Finally, the rift was too large to patch any longer. In anger and frustration, Tina moved out of the house with Sarah and Kody. Larry was devastated. He recalled, "There was real anger between us at first. I felt betrayed, and so did she. There was some yelling and accusations. It was not a happy time." One thing neither Larry nor Tina ever did was use Sarah and Kody as bargaining chips against the other. They both knew that no matter what, they were still the children's parents. As time eased the bitterness, both Larry and Tina realized that it was circumstances more than character flaws that had driven them apart. At heart, they were both good people who wanted the best for Sarah and Kody, and at some level, they still both loved each other. Larry said later, "I couldn't stay angry at Tina. She was the first love of my life. She was the mother of my children. There wasn't a mean bone in her body. But the truck driving was just too much for the both of us." 3. Sarah and Kody. Tina, Sarah, and Kody got an apartment in the town of Hilliard, a suburban area like Reynoldsburg and Hamilton, on the west side of Columbus, Ohio. Even though they were no longer under the same roof, Larry said, "I wanted to see as much of my kids as I could. I was really proud of both of them. They did really well in school, and both Sarah and Kody were very athletic. You know how kids can be pretty mean at times, excluding others from their group? Unpopular kids are kind of pushed to the side. But when Kody saw that kind of thing, He would go out of his way to include those kinds of kids. And he wouldn't allow any bullying around him. That was the thing about both Kody and Sarah. They had kind hearts. Maybe it was because they were generally upbeat and happy that they didn't like to see sadness in other kids. I got together with them every chance I got. Despite seeing his kids once in a while, Larry was also lonely. In 2005, he met a pretty dark-eyed brunette named Tracy, and before long, they started dating. Tracy had a sweet way about her, was charming, and always wanted others to feel comfortable. Where Tina was rambunctious and outspoken, Tracy was quiet and calm. The women, however, did have at least one characteristic in common. A caring nature. They were very loyal to friends and family, and good people at heart. Shortly after they started dating, Larry and Tracy married and began a new life together. A son, AJ, was born in 2006. Like Kody, he was a good and caring boy, and he loved his big brother, Kody, and his big sister, Sarah. Life for Tina was changing as well. She met a man named Greg Borders who worked at the Target Distribution Center where she was employed, and they began dating. After a while, they moved into an apartment together with Kody and Sarah in Hilliard, and as luck would have it, they soon had new neighbors down the street. Larry, Tracy, and their baby boy, AJ. By now, any acrimony between Tina and Larry was a thing of the past. He said later, "We had matured by then, and we both loved our kids. We didn't want to argue in front of them or about them. Both Tina and I wanted the best for them." In a lot of ways, it was a convenient situation. Larry got to see Sarah and Kody more often than he had in the past few years. In fact, by 2006, it was one of the happiest times of his life. Larry was driving now locally rather than on the long-distance trips that had taken him away for weeks at a stretch. Larry said, "We'd have Sarah and Kody over for 3 or 4 days at a time. I was driving locally, so I got to see them a lot. I'd toss a football around with Kody, and we'd do things together like any father and son. I was real proud of my kids. They both did well in school and were just happy-go-lucky kids. Sarah and Kody would squabble about things, as a brother and sister will do, but basically they got along. When Kody played junior league football, Sarah actually became a cheerleader for the team." Tina's mother, Barbara Herman, recalled of Tina around this time, "She was a fun-loving hard worker and very caring mother. She loved dolphins and sunflowers, but most of all, she enjoyed watching and cheering on her children as they participated in sports. Kody was a good student and loved playing guitar in his spare time, and Sarah was very athletic." Everything might have gone along in that manner, but then the economy intervened. The boom times in America were over. In 2008, Tracy lost her job. Soon thereafter, Larry was also laid off. Desperate for money, he decided to take a truck driving job in Kentucky. Once again, he knew it would take him away from Sarah and Kody for long periods of time, but now he had Tracy and AJ to take care of, too. Larry and his family moved down to Kentucky, and he began hauling fuel for a mining company there. His visits with Sarah and Kody were now confined to birthdays and around the holidays. It was disappointing, but times were very lean, and Larry and Tracy were happy to just have a roof over their heads and a paycheck coming in. This situation went on for about a year and a half, and then Larry was offered a truck driving job in Florida. Despite being even farther from Ohio, Larry decided that it was worth the better pay and the better environment for his family. So he, Tracy, and AJ moved down there. One day out of the blue, Larry received a surprise phone call from Tina. She said she was thinking of moving down there with Sarah and Kody to live near him in Florida. She said nothing of Greg being part of the move, and Larry assumed that meant she was breaking up with him. Larry was all for this move, since he would be able to see his kids more often. He encouraged Tina to start making plans to move there. but Tina got other advice from her father. He said she should hang on to the new job she had found after getting laid off in 2008. Good jobs were not easy to find in Florida in a bad economy. Perhaps swayed by this reasoning, Tina decided to stay in Ohio. She did make one profound move, however. Looking around for a nice area in which to raise her kids, she decided on Apple Valley, an upscale community 5 miles east of the county seat of Mount Vernon in Knox County, and about 50 miles northeast of Columbus. Greg, Tina, Sarah, and Kody moved to Apple Valley, a picturesque spot located on a beautiful lake. There were several beaches for swimming and large stretches of water for boating and fishing. Some of the more luxurious homes were lakefront properties with boat docks and piers. The surrounding area, marked by rolling hills and myriad trees, offered lots of space for kids to run around, and the town had a good school system. It was, simply, a great place for kids to grow up. Their new home was situated on King Beach Drive, with a large backyard for the kids to play in. It was somewhat isolated from the other homes, with farmland beginning just across the road that ran on one side of the house. Instead of houses across the street, there was a large patch of woods. Nonetheless, the area seemed like a safe environment for the kids. Nothing really bad had ever happened in Apple Valley. Not only was the location ideal, Tina quickly became very good friends with Stephanie Sprang, 41, who lived only 2 houses away on Majors Drive. Stephanie was just as lively as Tina, and the two got together to go shopping, took turns watching each other's kids, and enjoyed just hanging out with one another. Sarah and Kody would often play with Stephanie's 3 children. The elder boy, named Michael, was in his late teens. Her daughter Trish was a little older than Sarah, and her son Seth was younger than Kody. All of the kids got along well, which made the friendship between Tina and Stephanie even better. Tina and Greg did go in together on buying the house, but there was a downside. While Tina's job at a Dairy Queen restaurant was local, Greg had to drive almost 60 miles each way to the Target distribution center. It meant that he had to get up around 3 a.m, which was no small inconvenience, but he endured it. In 2010, Larry's grandmother moved into a nursing home, leaving him the house in Hamilton. He'd always had fond memories of the place, and he and Tracy decided to leave Florida and move there. It was a very nice suburban house with a large yard, and even though Columbus was just up the highway a few miles away, the new home felt as if it were more in the country than in the city. As luck would have it, Larry got a job offer to deliver fuel to gas stations in the region. It seemed like an ideal opportunity. Not only would he, Tracy, and AJ be able to live in an area they liked, but Larry would again be able to see Sarah and Kody on a more regular basis. Sarah and Kody continued to do well in school, and Sarah joined the softball team. She was very good at it, and her team even played in a regional competition. Kody took up baseball, and by the age of 10 was an excellent pitcher. One of Larry's favorite photos of Kody was of him winding up on the pitcher's mound. Tina spent more and more time with her friend Stephanie Sprang. Stephanie, just like Tina, was bubbly and the life of the party. One of Stephanie's cousins echoed Larry's words about Tina when she said, "Stephanie would walk into a room and light it up. She just had that kind of personality. She laughed a lot and seemed like a happy person." Stephanie and Tina were the best of friends and did everything together around Apple Valley. Stephanie had worked at a golf course for many years, but by 2009, she did odd jobs around Mount Vernon and Apple Valley to make extra money. One of those jobs took her to Columbus Road in Mount Vernon to work at the house of a strange young man, a young man who liked climbing up into trees. In August of 2010, Larry and Kody had one of their most memorable experiences. Kody had always told Larry he wanted to go night fishing. One evening, Larry got some bait, loaded up an ice chest with hot dogs and soft drinks, and took Kody out to a lake. Larry later said he had a blast. Kody was the only one to catch some fish, and he was real proud of that fact. And they were good-sized fish. It was something that was just fun for a father and son to do. I looked forward to a lot more times like that with him. Just me and Kody going out to do fishing or whatever. That August, I thought we had all the time in the world to do things like that. There was another trip, in October 2010, that Tracy Maynard recalled fondly. She said later, "On October 24th, 2010, I took Sarah, 13, Kody, 11, AJ, 4, and Peyton, 2, Larry and Tracy's youngest boy, who was born in 2008, to the Columbus Zoo. It was Boo at the Zoo, a Halloween event for kids. All the kids enjoyed riding the rides there, and they didn't want to leave until the zoo closed. On the drive home, we laughed and talked about everyday things. I dropped Sarah and Kody off at their mom's house and gave them a hug goodbye. I told them we'd soon go to the wild lights at the zoo, which was a pre-Christmas event. But fate would intervene before that took place. The small city of Mount Vernon was a picture postcard kind of town. Compared to the inner city problems of Cincinnati, Cleveland, or even nearby Columbus, Mount Vernon's troubles were few and far between. With its large brick courthouse, post office, city hall, and churches, it seemed a small-town paradise where residents reveled in a sedate, comfortable way of life. Crime was so infrequent, many people still left their doors unlocked day and night. If there seemed a constant in the area, it was a feeling of contentment. But there was one individual in its midst who was not content. Matthew John Hoffman was a troubled and angry young man living in his two-story house on Columbus Road. He felt he'd been dealt some bad cards in his life, and there was a fire burning deep inside him, about ready to burst out of control. And by November 2010, that explosion was only hours away. 4. Young Matt. Even from an early age, Matthew John Hoffman liked being in trees. Like other boys his age, young Hoffman played baseball, but the subject with which he seemed most obsessed was trees. He loved going out into the woods and climbing them. Perhaps he saw climbing a tree as an opportunity to get away from whatever was troubling him. Perhaps he viewed the trees as a safe haven where he could forget the cares of the world, at least for a short time. Matt Hoffman was the son of Robert and Patricia Hoffman and grew up in the Warren area of northeastern Ohio. According to his mom, Patricia, he was a good boy, but high-strung. He was smart and had lots of energy, but he was also headstrong and rebellious. When he wanted his way, he tended to dig in his heels and not be swayed in the matter. Bright and intelligent, he could also be alarming at times. The things he said to people were off-kilter and confusing. If someone said good morning to him, Hoffman was apt to respond with, "What's so good about it?" More than one person would later recall how they would ask him a normal question and get an off-the-wall answer in return. In 1997, Hoffman's parents divorced, and Hoffman moved with his mother to the Mount Vernon area in Knox County. One neighbor, Alice Morelli, recalled Hoffman as a teenager, 14 to 16 years of age. She thought that he always seemed unhappy and acted strangely. Morelli said later, he was really lost. He was on a bad path. Hoffman did get into trouble around that time when he and some buddies climbed onto the roof of Lakeview High School. When caught by the police, his only explanation was that he just wanted to see if he could do it. Hoffman would also jump off his own roof onto a trampoline. There seemed to be something about heights that intrigued Hoffman. Morelli's dog hated the teen, constantly barking at him when he was in the yard. In response, Hoffman would merely stare, blank-eyed at the dog. It really concerned Morelli, who thought there was something wrong with the boy. His antics, she felt, went way beyond the usual childhood pranks. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Hoffman did not take well to high school, though he did graduate in 1999 and went on to study industrial electrical engineering at Knox County Career Center. Afterward, he went through a long list of jobs in a very short period of time, never seeming to settle down to anything. In 2000, Hoffman left Mount Vernon and moved to Steamboat Springs, Colorado, where his grandmother lived. The town was about as different from Apple Valley, Ohio, as could be imagined. At an elevation of around 5,000 feet, Steamboat Springs was an up-and-coming resort city geared to outdoor activities, especially skiing. In fact, Steamboat Springs was one of the fastest-growing cities in Colorado. Not unlike Vail and Aspen, it had become a hotspot for both winter and summer sports. Steamboat, as it was called by locals, had good restaurants, a thriving art scene, and lots of new condominiums in town and on the surrounding mountains. Some of the most luxurious new homes in the area were starting to sell for $5 or $6 million or even more. These homes were up on the ridge with commanding views of the whole area. People who owned these properties could fly their private jets into the local airport. Not that Hoffman was living in one of those expensive houses. He was working as a plumber's helper by this time, and his abode in Steamboat was the inexpensive D-Bar K Motel. It was the kind of place where a lot of other low-income workers also lived, mainly construction workers, maids, and other service-related individuals. Hoffman was away from his motel room for several nights in September 2000, however, and his fellow residents at the D-Bar K would have been surprised to know where he was spending his time. But it was not long before they found out, along with why he suddenly left the area without any warning. It happened right around the time an expensive condominium caught on fire, and the residents had to run for their lives from the burning set of buildings. Before the ashes settled, Matt Hoffman was long gone. 5. Fire on the Mountain. Around the time of the condo fire, the Steamboat Springs Police Department, SSPD, was aware that three city signs had been stolen from the city park in mid-September 2000, and they were able to trace their whereabouts to Unit 6 of the D-Bar K Motel. These were not small signs, but rather the large metal and wooden signs that welcomed visitors to the town. It must have taken a lot of effort to remove them, and it had to be done when no one was watching. The local police learned that Matt Hoffman had been the sole renter of Unit 6, and upon entering the unit, the officers found one of the signs. The other two were found under the building. Officer Del Valle reviewed the Central Park Management rental application that Matt had been required to fill out to rent the D-Bar K unit. Hoffman had listed his grandmother's phone number on the rental agreement form. Del Valle telephoned the number and spoke with Hoffman's grandmother. She told Del Valle that Hoffman had been in the Steamboat Springs area recently, but had since left. A short time later, Hoffman's mother in Ohio, Patricia, phoned Del Valle and asked why the police department was inquiring about her son. Del Valle explained the circumstances, and Patricia said she would have Hoffman contact him as soon as possible. 6 days later, Del Valle received a voicemail from Matt Hoffman, requesting a callback and giving a phone number where he could be reached in Ohio. Del Valle called Hoffman at 5:50 p.m. on September 14, 2000, and asked if he had stolen three signs from the city park. Unexpectedly, Hoffman said that he had and that he was solely responsible for their theft. In fact, he gave details of loading the signs into a pickup truck that had a rack and then transporting them back to the D-Bar K Motel. Del Valle asked Hoffman why he had stolen the signs. His answer was simple. I wanted some souvenirs from Steamboat. Ironically, however, he hadn't taken them with him when he left town. Devaye told Hoffman, "Well, you have the opportunity to return to Steamboat on your own accord and expense, or be arrested and formally extradited." Hoffman said he would return on his own. To this, Devaye replied, "You have until September 26th to do so. If you don't show up, a warrant for your arrest will go into effect on September 27th. In passing, Officer Devaye mentioned Hoffman's confession to Detective Ross Kelly of the SSPD. Ross's ears perked up at Hoffman's name. He knew that Hoffman had been employed by Scott Barnes Plumbing, which had a maintenance contract with Johnson Shipley Management, the company that had provided plumbers for the Ridge Condominiums complex that had burned. Ross also knew that 2 weeks prior to the fire, which had been deemed a case of arson, a plumber had done some work in condo number 7, the very unit that the arson investigator had since determined was the point of origin for the fire. On September 26, 2000, Matt Hoffman showed up at SSPD headquarters in Steamboat Springs, and Officer Devaye advised him of his Miranda rights. Hoffman signed a waiver of his rights, and Devaye started asking him questions about the theft of the "Welcome to Steamboat Springs" signs. Hoffman stated that he'd asked a friend at the D-Bar K Motel, who went by the name Freedom, if he could borrow his red Nissan pickup truck, and according to Hoffman, Freedom had willingly agreed. So around midnight one night, Hoffman decided to steal the 3 signs. Delvalle showed Hoffman photos of the recovered signs in the condition they were found. Hoffman looked at the photos and agreed that was the way he'd left them. Hoffman then added that he was glad they'd recovered all the parts of the signs that had broken off when he was removing them from their mountings. Delvalle asked Hoffman once again why he'd stolen the signs, and Hoffman replied, "I wanted them for a novelty." Delvalle asked Hoffman what his occupation was, and Hoffman said that, until recently, he'd worked for the Scott Barnes Plumbing Company. Delvalle asked if he'd installed a garbage disposal at the Ridge Condominium, Unit 7. Hoffman responded that he and Scott Barnes had indeed installed a garbage disposal there and had also unclogged a tub in a different unit. Delvalle then asked if Hoffman knew there had been a fire at the condominium, and Hoffman said that he did. To this, Delvalle asked, "Why would your fingerprints be found on several boxes found in the condo owner's vehicle?" This was a vehicle that had been stolen from the garage of the burned-out condo number 7 at around the same time. Hoffman replied, "I may have picked up the boxes and moved furniture that was in the way of the plumbing job." Delvalle responded, "Why would you have to move furniture and boxes to install a garbage disposal?" Hoffman didn't answer the question, but rather just sat there in silence. Delvalle next asked, "Why were your fingerprints found on the driver's side door of a white Chevrolet Suburban? That Suburban was stolen and filled with property from condo number 7. Hoffman responded, "I may have touched the Suburban. I went and looked at it." None of this added up, so Delvalle asked, "Why would you go look at the Suburban?" Hoffman answered, "I found the keys in a drawer in the kitchen. I took the keys and went into the Suburban." "Okay, so did you drive the Suburban and park it by the clock tower building?" This was a building near the center of town. Hoffman replied, "I only drove the vehicle on Ridge Road." To this, Delvalle said, "You must know where I'm going with this questioning." Hoffman agreed that he did and responded, "Okay, you obviously got me." Officer Delvalle excused himself from the room and met with Detective Kelly. He asked Kelly to come into the room with a tape recorder and case reports about the condo fire. After a short period of time, Delvalle and Kelly went back into the room where Hoffman was sitting. Delvalle introduced Kelly to Hoffman and said that Kelly was the investigating officer on the arson fire. Both Delvalle and Kelly began asking Hoffman about the items that had been stolen from the condo and placed in the Suburban. Hoffman admitted that he'd taken a stuffed mountain lion, a wood dresser, and a bag of clothing from the condo. When asked about a bear rug, antelope head, and wooden bench, Hoffman said that he had not stolen those and they must have burned in the fire. Apparently, he had left the mountain lion, wood dresser, and bag of clothing in the stolen vehicle. Asked about office equipment, Hoffman recalled that he'd stolen a fax machine and placed it on the passenger seat of the Suburban, and he'd also taken a small camera. Hoffman continued, "I took items two times, one of which was on the night of the fire. I was in that condo five times. I stayed in there and watched TV because my own place didn't have cable TV. I cooked myself meals and used the jacuzzi." Hoffman was able to do all of those things because he knew the condo owner was out of town. The officers asked why he set the fire. Hoffman replied, "I burned the place to cover up the crime because my fingerprints were all over the place. I couldn't have cleaned all the prints. I had no choice. I had to start the fire." When asked what kind of accelerant he'd used to start the fire, Hoffman replied, "You already know what I used. It was premium gasoline." The officers wanted to know what containers he'd carried the gasoline in, and Hoffman responded, "Didn't you find the containers? There's always a lot of evidence left after a fire. I used milk containers." Then he laughed, saying that he was just kidding about that. He'd actually bought two plastic gas cans at a local Walmart store on August 26th. The officers wondered where he'd bought the gasoline, and Hoffman said he'd purchased it at a Total gas station. Then he drove back to the condo, with the full gas cans, in a red Monte Carlo. Just whose vehicle this was, he did not say. He decided to drive the Suburban to the Clock Tower building, where he planned to pick it up the next day with all the stolen goods inside. Of course, Hoffman did not have permission to be using the Suburban. Hoffman continued, "I parked the Suburban, walked back to the condo, and sat inside watching television all day. I regretted what I knew I had to do. I watched TV until the early morning hours of the 28th. I poured the entire 10 gallons of gasoline on the floors of all the rooms in the condo and ignited the fuel."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.